Our next session is a conversation with Mr. Ashish Dhawan, founder and CEO of Central Square Foundation. Ashish will be in conversation with Samyukta and Sairaj. Samyukta Shinde is a student at UWC Mahindra College in Mumbai. She is currently working on Project Sanchetna, which aims at creating safe spaces for dialogue around feminism and expression using arts. Sairaj, a 12th grader from Pune, is passionate about theater and public speaking. In school, he was a part of the Maya musical by Teach for India. Over to you, Sairaj and Samyukta, to introduce Mr. Ashish and start the conversation on transforming the education system.
Yeah, thank you, Deek. And it gives me immense pleasure to welcome Mr. Ashish Dhawan to Inspire 2020. Mr. Dhawan is the founder and chairman of Central Square Foundation and a founding member of the Ashoka University. Prior to this, he worked for 20 years in the investment management business and ran one of India's leading private equity funds, the Chris Capital.
In June 2012, he left his full-time role at Chris Capital to start CSF to pursue evidence-driven and innovation-led system reform in school education. Ashoka University is a not-for-profit university that aims to offer an Ivy League quality undergraduate program in India based on the US liberal education system. So let's get started. Mr. Ashish Dhawan, thank you for being here today with us. Can you tell us a little bit about yourself, maybe describe yourself in 10 words?
I would say I'm an entrepreneur, very passionate about education, and here to change the system.
And since you're talking about, like you said, you are passionate about education and you're here to change the system, may I ask you, what is an excellent education to you?
Yeah, I think an excellent education is a well-rounded education, one that sets you up to succeed in life, and one where you have certain basic numeracy and literacy skills which open up the world of knowledge for you. So beyond the socio-emotional learning, the whole child, I think the idea that certain basic skills are extremely critical in order to be functional later in life. So that for me is at the core of good education.
Thank you so much for sharing that. I'm sure that like most of us would agree with that definition. And you have so much knowledge about the education system, and your journey with CSF has given you access to so much data. So what do you think the truth of India's education system is today?
Yeah, so you know, it's tragic that even though we have made a lot of progress in India in opening up lots of schools, almost every child now from class 1 to 8 goes to school, whether it's a boy or girl, whether it's someone from a scheduled caste or tribe, or OBC, you know, any background, children are now going to school. In primary, it's almost universal, that almost 100%. And even class 6 to 8, it's 95%+ of children are going to school. So that's a big achievement. We have 1.5 million schools in India, so lots of schools. But I think the real tragedy is, even though children are going to school, learning levels in India are still very, very low. And so there's a metric called learning poverty, which the World Bank introduced. And basically it means that a child by class 5 or age 10 cannot read simple class 2 or class 3 text. And why that's important is, if you can't read, you cannot progress further. You can't transact the curriculum. You can't read the books in class 5 or 6, etc. And India, by that measure, has 55% learning poverty, which means 55% of children can't read at age 10. Sri Lanka, which is our neighbor, is at 15%. And countries like China are also close to 15%. Vietnam, which is similar to India in economic development, is also sub 20%. So I think this is the biggest problem we have. We need, and you all, I'm sure, can attest to this, that if a child can't read, write, do basic mathematics, you can't progress any further. The world of knowledge, you are shut out from it. And so that's really what I feel we all need to work on in terms of solving. How do we take that 55% down to 15% by 2030? The good news is the Prime Minister has just launched a mission which will last for the next 5 years. I don't think we'll get it down to 15% to the Sri Lanka level or the China level. But my hope is by 2030, we can get it there. So that for me would be the single biggest thing that I would work on over the next decade.
Really, like, it's true that we have progressed to a level where most of us have, joined schools. And you say that it isn't enough, and there is a journey that we have to be on. So can you please share some of the innovations that we need currently to transform the education system that we have?
Yeah, so I'll break it up into two parts, what I call the bookends of education. So obviously the early years, which are very, very important, like I just described. And obviously, socio-emotional learning is an important part of it also. We want a healthy, happy child who is learning to read, write, basic math. But we also need to look at the tail end, right? Which is when you are an adolescent, maybe the academic stuff is important, but beyond that, how you're being prepared for life, prepared for the workplace, the sort of school-to-work transition or school-to-life transition, I think is very important. I think in terms of innovation, I have to give a lot of credit to NGOs in India. I think what they have managed to do is show that it is possible to solve our problems at both ends, whether it's the early years, getting children to these basic skills, or even this school to life transition. So we have lots of good models in India. We can look outside in India and see what other countries have done. But we can stand on the shoulders of these NGOs who have done good work. The problem has been in India that whilst Akansha may run 20 good schools, or Pratham may run a good program in Punjab or some other state, or some other Room to Read is doing a great job in one district in Madhya Pradesh, somehow the whole system as a whole is not improving. So out of the 1.5 million schools, 1.1 million are government schools. How do we get them all to learn from the best practices out there and improve? So I don't think we need a secret formula or innovation. I think what we need is a lot of clarity that we are going to focus on class 1, 2, and 3, that we are going to define what the goals are in terms of what children need to learn, communicate that widely to all parents, all teachers. Every parent should know, mere bacche ko padhna chahiye, at this level by class 3. And it's easy for a parent then to test that or to check that and to hold a school or teacher accountable. I think you also need, from a teacher standpoint, a little bit of support. We need to invest more in our teachers, give them the right training, build their capacity, more time for reflection. We need to give them the right tools to succeed, more structured tools so that they can succeed in the classroom, and provide them with coaching and mentoring. I think that's very important. We need to reach out to parents and to students directly. Get parents more engaged with the system. Again, the good schools do it, but the average school does not. So, and also get the child more involved in the education system and in the process. I mean, you all instinctively know when something isn't working, you're bored in class, you're feeling that this education is irrelevant. How do you make it more interesting? And learn from the students. So you get hear their voice, get feedback from them. I think that's very important. And then we need to monitor this regularly so that we know how we are progressing in terms of achieving this goal. So I think we need this overall framework. We need to inspire the system, but we need to have clear goals. We need to provide support. and we need to monitor and measure so that we are achieving this on a regular basis. So now that we have this mission coming, which the government is going to launch, it will create this energy. There's the opportunity to inspire and get things to happen. And so I hope that all of us in the country can come together and support this mission and support not just government schools, but even private schools. We have 4,50,000 private schools. How can we support them, the principals, the owners, so that they can, so if as a country can we come together to say class 1, 2, and 3 is part of this mission. We want to get every child in school to learn to read, write, do basic mathematics by class 3. And if we can achieve that, that would be our single biggest achievement. So I think more than innovation, we need to learn from what has already worked. We need to design things, a program design that works for the system, but just focus on execution and measure to see are we achieving against that, and inspire. Motivate our teachers. Don't pull them down. Motivate them, inspire them. Tell them that, look, this is a mission that's been created for them. And they play the most important role in our society. If we can take that approach, I'm sure that all of us together will be able to work to achieve these goals.
Thank you for sharing that with us. So you spoke about the importance of the role that teachers and parents and students can play. So what do you think specifically, what are the roles that maybe these stakeholders are going to play when it comes to education in the coming 10 years or so?
Yeah, so I think all the stakeholders play very important roles. I mean, obviously, let's take the teacher. You know, the teacher is, it doesn't matter whether she's teaching under a tree or a classroom, although of course we would prefer a classroom with furniture. But she is the one who needs to be not just skilled, but highly motivated, and to have a genuine interest and belief that every child can learn, and to really care about the struggling learners. I think if we want our system to improve, if you look at other countries that have improved, they have paid a lot of attention to the bottom 50% of the class. Because what tends to happen in any class is the teacher loves the children who are doing well, the top 10, 20%, teaches to them and forgets about particularly the bottom 50%. So I think getting teachers to have more belief, giving them the tools, getting them to disproportionately focus on the bottom 50% is very important. And then we have these intermediate people who come to visit schools. Right now, they just collect data. They do boring administrative work in the government system. Train them to become more observers, to give feedback, coaches in some way, so that they can help the teachers, so that teachers have a support system. And amongst themselves, teachers have a support system as well. The parent, I think, you know, already in some cases is sending the child to school, but there are some states like UP and all where I think we need to educate the parents that at a minimum, you know, attendance is very important. Actually, attendance is quite low. You may not see it in Mumbai or some of the big cities, but in these rural places, we have to tell parents that school mein bharti karana is not enough. They need to go to school, and that the parents should be involved for 10, 15 minutes a day in the child's education. And the parents should demand not just that the child is going to school, teacher is showing up, ki certain minimum goals are achieved. The parents should know ki the child should be a prime minister announced that children should be reading at the speed of 30 to 35 accurate words per minute by class 3. Every parent should be looking at that and saying, has my child managed to achieve that competency, and be demanding change from the bottom. And then children, I think, have a very important role. If we can get them excited, inspired, get them to be part of this mission, I think we underestimate the potential our children have and the role that they can play as a stakeholder. We always think of them as more passive vessels who are just sitting in the classroom. And so making them more active in the teaching learning process, I think is going to be critical. And then getting all the other system actors, you know, the NGOs, the funders, everybody aligned. So all the stakeholders have to be aligned around a common goal and have to work in mission mode. We have to all work 24/7 for the next 5-10 years to solve this problem in our country.
Yeah, and be like staying on that track, where do you see the country's education system 5 years from now? What is your hope for it, and where should our focus be?
I told you before, I think our focus should be class 1, 2, and 3 and preschool, where we can fix preschool. In the government system, it's a little bit harder, but preschool. So age 3 to 8 should be our focus. And I think our goal should be that we energize the system so that this 55% learning poverty comes down to 30-35% in 5 years, and that our children, at a minimum, should be reading with comprehension by class 3 at a basic level and by class 5 at a slightly more advanced level, and basic addition, subtraction, division, multiplication, every child should know, because beyond that, they can't do it any further, and that they must be happy, and that they must develop as human beings and be prepared for life. You know, so socio-emotional learning, have grit, all these character traits that will make them sort of happy, successful human beings, productive citizens of the country and the world. That's my hope for our system.
Yeah. Thank you for your time. It's been great, learning from you. It was inspiring. And over to you, Didi.
No, thank you both. You are the ones who are the change makers in our country. So I should have been asking you the questions versus the other way.
Thank you so much, Ashish, Samyukta, and Sairaj. Thank you.
Thank you.